Hello and welcome to Impact News. I'm Raj Nongthgombam, bringing you an exclusive conversation with one of the finest and influential and very popular political personality from Northeast India, who has recently been sworn in as the Chief Minister of Meghalaya and who is also one of the youngest Chief Ministers of India. Yes, you have guessed it right. He is none other than the 12th Chief Minister of Meghalaya, Mr. Conrad K. Sangma. Conrad sir, welcome to Impact News and also welcome to Manipur, though you already received a grand reception yesterday given by NPP Manipur State Unit. Okay, my first question is, you had been a campaign planner for your father, you had been an MLA, you had been finance minister of the state, you had also been opposition leader in the Meghalaya Assembly, you had also been recently the Lok Sabha MP, and now you are the Chief Minister of the state. So how do you see the change in your roles and responsibilities?
Well, it's the responsibility or the position has been changing, but ultimately the responsibility is the same, that we are working for the people.
Okay.
So I've been working for the people in different positions. But yes, it's been very fast, because once you work as an MP, it's a different kind of a responsibility, different kind of a role. When you work as a chief minister, it's a different kind of a role, and the responsibilities are much more. So yes, it's been fast, but ultimately the goal is to work for the people. Okay. So I've been working for the people,
Okay, to work for the people. All right. So like your father, your sister Agatha, and yourself migrated or somewhat like come back from the national politics to the state politics. So what is the reason behind that? Is there any conscious decision behind that?
No, actually, really, I was not really planning that I would be back in state politics. I was in state politics in 2008, but after my father passed away, I had been given a role to lead the party and to build up the party. And it makes more sense for me to be, there in center and build the party and work towards it. I can give more time to it. That is what I thought. Mm-hmm. And but then circumstances led me to come and be in the state, because the kind of numbers that came out after the election, the coalition partners were very much pressing for me to come and lead. And so therefore, depending on that and situation, I had to come back to state politics. Otherwise, I was very much working and settling down in Delhi.
Yeah.
In a way.
Okay, having said it, but your party, NPP, has this ideology that, I don't know, still it is, the party is having the same ideology, but initially your party has this ideology that the voice of the small states in Northeast India should be heard in the national politics. So that's why you went there in the Lok Sabha.
Absolutely.
And even we heard your Medan speech in the Lok Sabha. It was quite impressive. You were talking about Kashmir issues. So we like more people like you who can keep an impression, who can leave a mark in the national arena.
I will, even by being in state politics, I will continue to speak for the Northeast.
Mm-hmm.
And you're absolutely right that this idea has always been there. It's not that we have come out with this idea now. So even from my late father's time, and even from senior leaders who have been always there in politics, they felt the need that leaders from Northeast must come on a common platform.
Mm-hmm.
And many platforms were formed,
okay.
You see. But then everybody was in their own political party.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore this platform never could actually take off.
Okay.
Because you had a party from Nagaland coming in, you had a party from Meghalaya coming in, Mizoram, Sikkim. So you don't have a common platform. So late Mr. P.S. Sangma felt that there was a vacuum. And as you know, in politics, vacuum cannot be there. So he felt that there was a vacuum to get everybody on board.
Mm-hmm.
And that is how he started. And it is a seed that he's sown, and the idea that he's put in, we are simply continuing it. And yes, we stick with the ideology that there must be a platform for the Northeast. There must be a voice for the Northeast.
Mm-hmm.
And I keep mentioning this again and again, that obviously everybody is patriotic. Everybody thinks about their, their people, their tribe, their community. But at the same time, there are certain areas which are common to all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And it is those common areas that we as a political party feel that we can voice our opinion in, and many of them are there. And a lot has to do with lot of economic issues that Northeast India faces. And I think that there's definitely a common line, a common factor,
mm-hmm.
that goes through all the states.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the area which we're looking at. And I think people are responding to it. And that is the reason why we're seeing that people feel that there is a need for a platform and a political party like this.
But in addition to that, most of the MPs from Northeast India, like smaller states other than Assam, they are being accused of not voicing much in the Lok Sabha or in the Rajya Sabha. But we saw someone like you, you know, putting a lot of impressive voice in the Lok Sabha. So that's what I was actually talking about. Like, we want more people.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe Lok Sabha. Yeah. Or maybe the Rajya Sabha too.
yeah, you're absolutely right. We do need. But it's not that others did not. Everybody, I think, has been speaking at their own capacity. So I don't want to undermine anybody as such. Mm-hmm. But yes, you're right. We do need. Mm-hmm. And it is only when we voice our opinions, you know, then we are heard in Delhi. And I can tell you, every time I spoke it was very much with really concern for the Northeast. And the good part is whenever I spoke, you know, ministers used to take note of it, you know, and officials used to take note of it. Right. Because when I used to go and meet the officials again, said, yes, I know you spoke in Parliament also about it, you know. So I see the impact of it. So I think it's necessary. Okay. It's important that they do. And I hope more and more people come out who would be more, you know, vocal about these issues like this.
Today you are the Chief Minister of the state, and your sister is also in the league, as a legislature. Your brother is the Home Minister in your cabinet. So entire family is in your side in the government, directly or indirectly. So like your father would be, you would have been so happy and proud seeing the party growing from 12 into 12 two seats in 2013 and now 19 seats, and forming a coalition government, and his sons becoming the Chief Minister and the Home Minister. So he would have been very proud.
Yes, absolutely. I think he has been our idol, and he has been our mentor, mm-hmm. our teacher, and we are here because of him.
Okay.
And to be frank, I keep telling people that there are many people who are hardworking, you know, many people who, you know, work and, you know, are methodical, you know, strategic. But then, I mean, so people think that, well, you know, during our time we have done this. But I think a lot of people don't realize that if Conrad Sangma was just a normal person who's, you know, trying to build up a political party, mm-hmm. Nobody would give him any importance. It is only because Conrad Sangma happens to be P.A. Sangma's son. Mm-hmm. And I go to somebody and say, will you join the party? You know, the party that was joined by formed by P.A. Sangma. People are like, oh, is it? Oh, you're P.A. Sangma's son. So I think that is, people don't realize, but that makes a big difference. Mm-hmm. And as I said, so there are a lot of people who would be forming political parties, a lot of people who are working hard, you know, and trying to, you know, establish a political party. But the difference is him, you see. And it is because of him that this whole party has got this brand that people believe in, you see. People don't know me, you see. Now, yes, maybe they know me that I'm Chief Minister, but it is the brand name of P.S. Sangma and the ideologies that he has, given to us and to the party, mm-hmm. is what is making the difference today.
Okay.
And so therefore, I'm sure he would be very happy to see the ideologies that he has and ideas that he has sown mm-hmm. are today taking shape. And so yes, we remember him and we thank him for everything.
Okay.
I'm sure he would be happy today.
Yeah. Sure. So talking about Congress and the Gandhi family, they have always been accused of dynasty politics. So how will you look at yourself? Like, your family is also, you know, more or less kind of joining the politics after your father?
No, you see, I keep telling people, if you look at in sports also, mm-hmm. you see, we always start training the footballers very young, you know, or any sports, in fact, when they're 12 years old, 13 years old, we try to train them then, because then what happens, they get an early start mm-hmm. and they can train and they can become better. But if they don't perform after 16, 17 years, 18 years of old age, then we know that even though we started training them early, mm-hmm. It's no use. So like in our case, what the same thing has happened.
Mm-hmm.
That in our case, we got an early training. We got an early training, we got an early option. My father started training us when we were 12 years old. We started, you know, traveling here and there with him. And we started, you know, moving around in politics
okay.
with him. But at the end of the day, after all the training and after all the work,
mm-hmm.
If we can't perform, then people will reject us.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, yes, we got an early start, we got an early option, but that does not ensure that we we can sustain or we can continue in politics in the long run.
Okay.
So it's also up to the people.
Okay, fair enough. So like talking about the governments in Meghalaya and Manipur and Nagaland, and they are recently formed governments and they are all coalition governments. So how do you ensure the stability of such coalition governments?
You see, coalition government is something that's there in a lot of parts of the country today. Mm. And simply because, you know, people have their own aspirations and their own ideas. And everybody expresses their ideas through the ballot paper. Mm-hmm. So coalition is something that you can't ignore. But I think there are certain mantras in politics and in coalition politics especially. If you, I'm not saying stick to it, but if you even follow it a bit, I feel it could help. Now, issues like, for example, proper communication, proper coordination, proper respect for your coalition partners, consultation, you know, in any decision. I think these are basic mantras that one should follow. So I feel that I don't want to comment on other states, but at least in my state, whenever I take any major decision, even now, and my coalition partners will agree and tell you that I consult them in everything. If there's a particular minister, if it is his department, I will always consult him or her, asking them that, well, what do you think we should do in this? When it comes to the MLAs, I always ensure that I consult the MLAs when it comes to any kind of decision within his or her constituency. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I think these basic mantras have to be followed. Mm-hmm. A coalition is not easy to run. It's always difficult. But that's the nature of politics today, and we have to live with it and work with it.
But why didn't you extend your partnership for the coalition government in Nagaland led by Nephew Rio, NDPP?
No, I think it was very clear. Before the election, we had signed an agreement mm-hmm. with the NPF that we will have a pre-post-poll alliance. You know, so it was not a pre, it was not a post. Mm-hmm. It was a pre-post alliance mm-hmm. That we would work with NPF. And I think that's another thing in politics that I think we all should understand, that when we are working in politics, I think commitment is very important. Mm-hmm. I think when you say something, you should mean it. Mm-hmm. So I think from that angle, I think when Mr. T.R. Zilian was there, when we had the agreement with him, I wanted to stick to that agreement. Mm-hmm. And but then when we saw that things were not moving in the direction we wanted to, and we saw that Mr. Rio has formed the government, then we had discussion with Mr. T.S. Elyang, and we, in a very fair manner, we said that, well, we should be allowed to move because we do not have a pre-poll alliance as such. It was, we fought against each other, you know, but we agreed to work after the election. So I think it was that reason why we waited. But then after that, we realized that we will not be able to form the government. And Mr. Rio also is somebody who is very close to us. And they also requested that let's work together mm-hmm. for the benefit of our people. So our MLAs also felt that, that we can work better mm-hmm. if we are with the coalition in Mr. Rio. And that's why we went ahead with it.
Okay.
But in the beginning, the main idea was that we had given a commitment and we would like to stick. And without telling our partners, mm-hmm. we would not want it to shift.
Okay, fair enough. As far as Manipur government is concerned, like NPP has got 4 seats and all of them are ministers now in the cabinet. So it means NPP has got strong say or more say in the government. So what is your comment on that?
No, I shouldn't say we have more say. Mm-hmm. I've always again believed that when it comes to coalition politics, all partners are equal. Mm-hmm. And I think that is very important for any coalition partner to understand. Whether you are a one member party or you're 4 member or you're 21 members, I think the importance for the chief minister or any the leader of the party should know that every political party is an equal partner mm-hmm. in the coalition. And so therefore, yes, we have 4 ministers, we have 4 MLAs, but I don't want to say that we control things or things, because we don't. Mm-hmm. Because, or we have got more, we don't have more. We are all equal partners and our goal ultimately is to serve the people. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, that's how I see it and that's how we work, whether it's here or any other part of the Northeast. We are very much focused on our goals. Mm-hmm. We're not here to see who's more powerful, who's got more ministers. That's not the way it is. But yes, we are happy. Mm-hmm. And that our ministers are there. I'm very happy our ministers are performing very well. In 2018, in fact, there was an award that was given to the health department. And I'm sure similar awards will come for finance also, and for sports also, and for tribal affairs also. Mm-hmm. So I'm happy that our ministers are performing very well. And I hope that the Manipur government delivers, and I'm confident mm-hmm. that the Manipur government will deliver and make a difference in the lives of the people out here.
Okay. Talking about the issues which are common to Meghalaya and Manipur is like the issue of anti-influx or the ILP demand. So like what is your stand or what is the stand of NPP as most of your allies like UDP, PDF and HSPDP, they all have this anti-influx agenda at the time of during the election campaign?
I think infiltration is an issue that affects the whole Northeast. Mm-hmm. And I think if you ask any political leader or any person, they will tell you that we are all worried about influx. So there is no doubt about it that it's an issue. I think what is important to understand is that there is a balance between economic development and infiltration. When we have economic development taking place, when we have more trade taking place, whether it's with Myanmar or Bangladesh, we know that the impact of that is going to be infiltration. We're going to see some level of infiltration taking place. Now, the issue here is infiltration. The point is, how do we check it? Mm-hmm. Now, there are many views and opinions about it. Some say ILP. Mm-hmm. Fair enough, it could be. Some say a work permit. Fair enough, it could be. Mm-hmm. Some say you should have that identity card. What's it called? NRCs. Mm-hmm. NRC. Fair enough. Mm-hmm. So, point is that there are multiple ways of handling that situation. Mm-hmm. But issue still remains the same. Nobody denies the fact that infiltration is an issue. We need to address it. Mm-hmm. The debate or the question lies is how to do it. And my personal feeling is that we should consult all our partners. That's why last time also I told my cabinet that let us consult, let us discuss. Mm-hmm. I think you are aware or maybe you're not aware, but we are having a meeting on the 4th of May mm-hmm. Where the External Affairs Minister, Madam Sushma Swaraj, she has called all the chief ministers of Northeast to discuss about Act East and about Northeast mm-hmm. and ASEAN countries, mm-hmm. Bangladesh. So she has called a meeting on the 4th. It's a very high level meeting and a very important meeting. Mm-hmm. And I think issues like this will be discussed in mm-hmm. that meeting also. So we can't shy away from it. We need to, you know, face it and find a solution, debate about it, discuss about it, consult with our people. And as I said, it's an important issue. But the question is how we're going to deal with it. Mm-hmm. And in that situation, everybody's opinion is there.
Okay. But other than infiltration, like Manipur is facing the influx from the migrant workers or the migrant people or the people from other parts of India. Okay. So don't you face such kind of situation there?
Yes, we do. We do. Everybody does. And it's a situation where it's happening anywhere in the yeah. In the country. So therefore, I mean, it's a genuine issue. As I said, influx of workers from outside, one cannot legally stop it right now. Because anybody who is a citizen of India has the right to move into any part of the country. So therefore, I think it's a challenge we all face. It's an issue that became a problem in our state also, and people are demanding for ILP in that issue also. So therefore, we'll see whether ILP is the solution for it or not, and can we actually stop it. From our state point of view, we are going to have some mechanism in place where we are going to be checking these issues. But is there any foolproof plan? I don't think so. Okay. You see, we cannot stop it on a foolproof plan. This is an economic cycle, mm-hmm. an economic process that takes place in any part of the world. Mm-hmm. It's not just that Northeast is facing it today. But you talk of America, you talk of UK. I mean, there was influx of migrant workers from everywhere. Yeah, so that's it's a normal cycle and phenomena that happens. And, you know, but ultimately, we need to see that economic development takes place mm-hmm. with ensuring that the local peoples or indigenous peoples mm-hmm. rights are protected. So that's what the challenge is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, talking about ILP, yesterday Chief Minister of Manipur wrote a letter to you about Bholaganj.
Yes.
Bholaganj village, maybe it's a village in East Khasi Hills, yes. Meghalaya. So mentioning about Manipuri households or Manipuri houses reducing from 200 to almost 30 to 50. So he was also saying that like these people, those Manipur people residing in Bholaganj, they have been denied with the Aadhaar cards and AY cards. Yeah. And they have also denied with the government benefits. So he asked your assistant on that. So what do you have to say on that?
It was brought to my notice yesterday mm-hmm. by the Honorable Chief Minister of mm-hmm. Manipur. And definitely we're going to look into this matter. As I said, any citizen who has been residing, you know, in Meghalaya, deserves to get at least the benefits that they have. But I think for what reason it's happening, I would not be in a position to reply right now. Mm-hmm. But definitely we'll go in and go back and check out the details, who these individuals are and how it happened, what is the background, what are the reasons why this didn't happen in the past. And if everything is in place, then definitely they cannot be denied the benefit and denied the development that they deserve. Mm-hmm. So, as I said, without doing the background check for me and without consulting with officials, I cannot say anything right now because I need to know the facts. Mm-hmm. But as I said, if everything is in place, nobody can deny development to the people.
So what will be your stand like?
So what will be your stand like? Manipur, Arunachal Pradesh, and Assam, they are facing some acute political problem, maybe. It's a political problem. Like after the signing of framework agreement on 3rd August 2015, these three states, Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, and Assam, they are talking about territorial integrity vis-a-vis the framework agreement. So what is your political stand?
See, it's a very complicated problem. There's no doubt about it. But I think certain principles have to be put in place. And I think Government of India has been very clear about it, that there's no question of compromising the territorial integrity of any state. So I think that should be just laid to rest. There is no reason for anybody to think that in any way the territorial integrity of any state will be affected. That has been, that chapter is closed. You see, now the issue is what are the other factors? How are they going to discuss? Those are issues that, I mean, to be very frank, we have not seen the agreement also. So we don't know what are the details of it. But I think there are certain benchmark principles that cannot be compromised. And territorial integrity is one of them. I'm just hearing that they're going to have different ways to strengthen their you know, their own rights and their own way. But as long as it does not affect other communities, and as long as it does not compromise on any of the communities' rights, I think this has to be discussed with everybody. And we have urged the Home Ministry, the Prime Minister, that whatever the discussion may be or decision may be, mm-hmm. every stakeholder must be consulted, mm-hmm. and people must be brought on board. So that, because this is a very serious thing, it's mm-hmm. not a small thing. So I think consultation is very important. And I have also urged the Honorable Home Minister and Prime Minister that whatever decision is taken, we must make sure that we consult with everybody and take everybody on board.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you have long schedule today, but one final question. How do you see the future of your party, NPP, in the coming year? And do you have any specific plan to plan for its expansion in the Northeast region or elsewhere in India?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about it.
Okay.
I mean, and we are not doing it from really looking at expansion mm-hmm. policy.
Okay.
That's not that we want NPP everywhere. But we are simply saying that we are here to voice the opinion of the people. Mm. And we feel that there is a vacuum for a platform that speaks for the Northeast. And we are urging people, voters, to come and give us the mandate so that we can voice the opinion of the people of Northeast. I keep telling people that when you go and meet a minister, and again, I'm not undermining anybody or I'm not speaking against anybody, but when MPs go and meet a minister, you will always find that there is one MP from Manipur or one MP from Meghalaya who goes and submits a memorandum to the minister. And in all likelihood, the minister might just simply take the memorandum and put it on side. And then suddenly you see there are 10 MPs who come from Bihar or from, you know, UP, and they're from one political party in the sub. And there's a complete different kind of a scenario out there. So, you know, and then suddenly you'll see that the officials are there and there's a conference table and room and everything. And when one MP goes from Northeast, you know, we just give 5 minutes, 10 minutes. We are trying to really address a practical problem. Mm. If there are going to be 5-10 MPs, if there are going to be 3-4 chief ministers of Northeast going and submitting a memorandum or discussing with the officials and the cabinet ministers of Government of India or any other you know, high dignitary, they will take us seriously. And this is the agenda which we're trying to, you know, convince the people that we are trying to take up. And that is why I feel that people nowadays, with all social media and media coverage everywhere, people of Northeast realize mm-hmm. that there is a need mm-hmm. for a platform that is going to speak for the Northeast. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the reason why I feel that people will give a chance to the NPP. And that is why you're seeing, whether it's Nagaland, whether it's Manipur, Meghalaya, or any other state in the Northeast, I'm confident, I'm very confident that people will give us an opportunity. And there's a reason why I feel that NPP will go from strength to strength. Okay. And it's not because of any individual. Mm-hmm. It's because of the idea and the ideology, which was laid down by Mr. P.S. Sangma. Mm-hmm. He's not there with us, but his idea will always remain. And that idea is what is going to take the party forward.
Mm-hmm. One small question, like in yesterday's speech of yours, you were talking about youths. You are going to make policies and programs for the youths, particularly to bring those youths on board. So what kind of activities and what kind of policies you're going to make for the youths?
See, I'm a very firm believer in the youth, in the power of the youth. Today you'll see that our youth are so enterprising. Mm-hmm. And you will see that the youth are not given the chance or the opportunity to really make a difference. I am a very firm believer even on entrepreneurship. Mm. So therefore, my policies, especially in my state at least, because I have got at least some control over policies in my state, we are going to work on entrepreneurship, you see. Now, entrepreneurship is very important. We must create an environment and we must create a culture of entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. What policies we require to create that kind of an environment, that is an issue that we have to address. Now, for example, ensuring that there is, in my state, we have created a separate fund for entrepreneurship. So in this budget, we have put a 4 crore budget, you know, where we will have training sessions for entrepreneurs. We'll have young entrepreneurs. We'll have, business plan competitions. We'll have incubation centers. We'll have discussion with, entrepreneurs. We will get investors. We'll get, whether it's banks or angel investors or whatever you call them. Mm-hmm. So we'll get investors on board. So incubation centers will be in place. So these are the kind of policies we need to create. So that's one sector. Mm-hmm. Youth has got many other aspects. Like, for example, youth is about sports. You see, now we are hosting the National Games in 2022, mm-hmm. Which is a very prestigious event for us. It also coincides with the 50 years of statehood of Meghalaya. So that is going to be a very, very important occasion for us and an event for us. And we plan to maximize the benefit of that. So sports is going to be very important. I feel sports, culture, music, I think there should be different specific policies that promote our youth in that line also. So there are many aspects. I can go on and on. It might take forever. But I think youth specific policies are required. We are coming out with a youth policy. Mm-hmm. I have given my youth department a target that in the next 6 months, the youth policy will have to be passed. Mm-hmm. Education policy has to be passed in the next 6 months. So we are working very aggressively on these kind of aspects. Mm-hmm. Meghalaya doesn't have a youth policy till now. Mm-hmm. Meghalaya doesn't have education policy till now. Okay. But we are going to have it in the next 6 months, the education and youth policy. I've given a specific direction to the departments that it must be complete. Mm-hmm. So we are already in the job. We're already having a consultative committee. We've already set up the different bodies. We have already, working on the draft. So things are moving in a very aggressive manner.
Okay, one final question. This will be the final question for the interview. Okay, Chief Minister was also talking about, Chief Minister Manipur was also talking about the issue of land record there in for the Manipur Bhavan in Meghalaya. Yes. So what is your comment?
Yeah, I have the letter mentioned about that also. Mm-hmm. But as I was mentioning that we have not really got a chance to go into it in detail. But it seems that there are some issues with the record of the land, mm-hmm. and documentation and all. But as I said, if everything is in place, there should not be any issue at all. Okay. And of course, it's a very important thing for Manipur. Mm-hmm. And I can assure you, Meghalaya would never come in between, what is the rightful, right of Manipur and its people. So therefore, definitely we'll look at it in a positive manner. We will try to assist in every possible way, mm-hmm. to ensure that this moves forward.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. It was pleasant talking to you. And thank you once again for taking out time for us from your busy schedule. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Well, that was Conrad Sangma, the Chief Minister of Meghalaya, sharing his views on politics, particularly politics in Northeast India, and about his political party, NPP. With camera person Chungkam Subhas, this is Raj Nongthgombam for Impact News.